One thing, we're going to hop in the presentation here, but I thought I would give you guys a little bit of some insights on what brought me here today. And in particular, I think this is not a career discussion whatsoever. I want to cover the content in here, but one of the things in my role today, I lead a customer insights team with Fidelity Investments over in Westlake. And what the organization does, we are struggling, as many organizations are today, with talent, right? A lot of people, kids come in 3, 4, 5 years, are moving out to other roles. So we started this thing called a career coaching center. And we have people like myself where we volunteer to go down a couple hours a week, whatever it is, and meet with various folks and coach them on their careers. And one of the things I found, and why this I think it's relevant to this presentation, is that folks, let's take project management, something near and dear to all of us. There are certain skills that today enable you or others that you work with to be successful in project management. There are people that are successful in business analysis, in IT, in leadership, operations management. And what I tend to see is that people focus on that career path and what they want to do and eventually, you know, achieve in their career, but without taking a step back and realizing that it's not that career path necessarily, it's the skills that make you successful in that career. It's the things that you've acquired by doing a certain role that if you step back and look at organizations, there's plenty of opportunities out there where you can apply your skills to be successful in other areas. And I've been in a number of different, I'll call it paths on my career, where I was a project manager for a number of years. I traveled around the country doing mostly implementations. I've always been in financial services. I've never worked in any other industry in 26 years now, where I was doing implementation for large plans coming in, bringing them onto 401k platforms. I then went into a lot of operations excellence work, so process improvement, trying to get things quicker, faster, better, more efficient. And then I went into a very strange twist in my career. Actually, then I was leading a business program management office for a number of years. And then a very strange twist happened that brought me to why I'm here today. And I wanted to kind of share a little bit of that context with you guys. So here's the story I want to open up with. So this was about 7 or 8 years or so ago. I was leading this business program management office. A lot of my job was spent what I would call managing the portfolio. So as I'm sure as you guys know, projects slip, projects slide. We have new projects come in, regulatory efforts, particularly in financial services, all the time. We're getting new regulation constantly, and election results could really affect what those regulations are going to be. So now we're trying to figure out what all that's going to mean over the next how many years. So my manager came to me and said, look, it's probably be really good opportunity for you. We're going to have this big planning session. It's going to be all the senior leaders in the organization. They're going to be in a room, 3-day offsite. I want you to attend. I go, really, it'd be important for you to kind of hear what the priorities in the organizations are, for you to understand really what these big things are. So as you're making these project trade-off discussions in the portfolio, you should know some of the history that brings us here. So I said, great. I knew a lot of these senior leaders individually, but I've never seen them all get together, right? I've never seen them work and how they would kind of collaborate. I was pretty excited about this, and I could tell you probably about 4 or 5 hours into this 3-day session, my excitement started going a little bit downhill. My initial reaction was that a lot of these senior leaders were up there talking about their individual business groups, talking about their priorities, but there was very little collaboration. There was all these kind of siloed discussions. And I think that went on for pretty much day one. So I left, I went home that day saying, okay, maybe that's just the first day. Everybody's warming up to each other. They're trying to get their arms around kind of what the big picture is. And day two would be much different. I went in there with, all excited, day two. And unfortunately, it was the same exact thing. So people going round and round discussion. And at that point, you start changing from being, okay, maybe I'm not getting a lot of value out of this, but you started getting pretty frustrated. Because number one, these are the people leading my organization, and I've got a lot of things tied to their success. Then also I have my email box filling up and all the work that I'm supposed to be doing that I'm not getting done because I'm attending this meeting. Day three came along and we were off to the same path. And one thing about myself is I'm not very good at being quiet and sitting back. And if I feel like something's going off the road, I tend to speak up. So it was probably about 10 o'clock on that third day. This meeting was professionally facilitated. They had people taking your parking lot and all these great notes and stuff. And we came back from a coffee break. And I like to play dumb sometimes, so I stood up and I said, hey, can you guys bear with me for a minute? I go, I need to just kind of collect my thoughts here. So I got up on the board and I said, what I'm thinking is, I think there's these 3 or 4 big things that we want to accomplish up here. Here's where we kind of want to go. And what I'm hearing from you is that there's these big chunk of work. I drew these little boxes. I said, there's these big chunks of work. We've got to deliver these things. And then here's some other kind of sub-deliverables. So what did I draw up on the board? A work breakdown structure, right. A work breakdown structure, a very simple one. My spelling's terrible, my penmanship's terrible, it was really messy. But when I drew that up on the board, and then I turned around for the first time with all these senior executives in the room, it was quiet. And then one person, she said back, she said, you know, this is exactly the picture we're looking for. And here I am in my brain, I'm like, I've done this 1,000 times for 1,000 projects in 1,000 rooms, but this was like new to these folks, right? It was like, wow, I can't see all this coming together, it all makes sense. For the next 2 hours, I started jotting down, flushing out all the various pieces of those chunks of work, and that thing became the structure that led to the strategic plan for our company for the next 5 years. About 3 months or so from then, I got the offer. I became a vice president of strategy and planning, a role what I had for 5 to 6 years. And what I want to bring to you guys, and why I said this skills, I have zero strategy experience. I have zero experience in leading corporate strategy or leading these efforts. But myself, like all of you, I have a lot of experience in planning. Because as project managers, where do you spend most of your time? Planning, right? So I wanted to kick that off and let you know. That's what brought me here today. You know, I could have, like I said, if I had kind of those blinders on and didn't realize the skill sets that I had from project management, I probably never would even thought, I would never have applied for a strategy and planning job. I wouldn't have thought I had that skill set. So let's see if I know how to, all right, here we go. So here's my objectives today. I'd like to review the 5 phases of strategic planning. They are very straightforward and simple. And what I want to do with each of these phases is I want to align these with project management tools and techniques. Throughout our discussion today, as I go through these phases, don't get so wrapped up in the strategy and planning. Think like project managers, because that's what I did when I went through and actually did this role again for 5 years or so. There are many things that, again, we kind of take for granted. We do these things all the time, but if you take these skills and you apply them in each of these phases, I think it'll be fairly straightforward, and it's a way you could definitely apply what you know in project management. And what could come out of this? This could prepare you to lead a strategic planning effort for your team, your business unit, or your company. Why should you care about this? Well, strategic planning roles are in demand, and they can be a rewarding career opportunity for project managers. This might not be an area you've thought of going into before, but it's a great opportunity for people that know how to plan, organize work, and drive results. Because, you know, I'll try not to be too cynical in some of these discussions and share too much of my thoughts. Some of those things are lacking in a lot of leaders and organizations, right? Some people are big thinkers. They can come up with big ideas. But when the rubber hits the road and pull these things together and drive results, they don't know how to do that, right? You have a lot of conversations with people. They don't understand what a critical path is. There's 5 things. We got to get all 5 things done. I'm like, well, that's not how it works, right? We have to figure that out. If you manage a team or 2,000, you should be developing and managing a strategic plan for your team. I'll constantly go back to this throughout the discussion. I believe the things that we're going to cover today, if you are leading, in my case, in my role, I was leading the strategic planning for a large organization, a subset of a bigger company, but it was called a self-sufficient business unit. If you're managing 2 or 3 people, I would challenge if you guys manage 2, 3, 5, 10, 15 people, your bosses, your managers, I wonder how many of them have strategic plans. I wonder how many of them know what their group will be doing in 5, 10, 15 years. How many people even think about that? We'll talk about this a little bit later. Things you guys are working on today and the things you are doing will be obsolete in a year, right? Things are changing constantly around here. And if we're not thinking ahead, we're not pulling that plan together, we could be left behind, your organization or your team. If you're not managing people, if you're an individual contributor working on a group, maybe this is an opportunity for you to pull this together for your team. Go to your boss, your boss's boss, and say, I don't think we have a strategic plan. Be careful with that. And then say, you know, here's what maybe I can do for us. I've learned these 5 phases. I'd love to do this for the team and try it out. Might be an opportunity. And then lastly, I hope, and I know that we spend a lot of time on infrastructure projects, regulatory projects, things that I say we have to do in project management, but I would hope that throughout your careers, you're working on projects that are leading or contributing, I should say, to an overall business unit strategy. So understanding how all of this kind of comes together may help you as you do your project management and understanding the importance of your project in the overall scheme of things. So, a lot of times people start out with a lot of good ideas, but they don't execute. They lose the purity of their vision. You end up running around in circles. So if my presentation was purely on the value of project management, I would put that same quote up there. But I look at this quote really around strategic plans, right? Corporations, business units, group communities, they need to have focus. Another one of my little pet peeves, which you'll hear throughout the discussion today, everyone, us, and everybody we work with, everybody's doing stuff, right? Everybody's always busy. There's stuff, right? I'm doing stuff. Stuff all over my desk, stuff. how much of that stuff is contributing to what your customers need, to what your business needs, and to moving your organizations forward? How much of it's non-value-added noise, right? I know in my space, a lot of it's non-value-added noise. And part of that is, in various organizations, if we don't know what we're aiming for, if we don't know what the end vision is, we're not going to hit it. And there's a saying that if you aim for nothing, you hit it every time, right? A strategic plan defines where we're going and how we will get there. And when I put this in, I didn't say defines your business, where it's going, your unit, your whatever, because this can be applied to anything, communities, churches, governments, organizations. There has to be a plan, something we're shooting for. And I think last time when I gave this presentation, I got the question at the end, which I was really a little bit startled at the end. Someone asked me, well, what's the difference between a project plan and a strategic plan? I said, well, maybe I didn't do a good enough job explaining that. So when I mean a strategic plan, any business unit, corporation, organization, there's something that you do every day. There's a product or service that you're providing at a minimum. That's meeting your customers' needs, whether internally or externally. Right? We're doing work, right? We're providing a service. A strategic plan, if we do that and we only stay there, we can become irrelevant, we can become outdated, technology, things move past us. A strategic plan is that long-term vision of where you want your business unit, your organization, or your company to go, right? It's what we're shooting for. It's what we're aiming to get to in the organization. It challenges us to think ahead, and it challenges an organization to anticipate what those needs are going to be in the marketplace and what those needs are going to be for us to basically operate effectively and efficiently and make ourselves relevant. Now, bringing that back to what I said earlier around if you're a group of 2,000 people, if you're a project management lead today and you have 2 or 3 people reporting to you, this still applies, right? If you're making your plan today of what you want your group to do, and the operations team who you never talk to is actually going to outsource all of their stuff to Bangladesh 6 months from now, and you're hiring 3 people to work domestically, you could be hiring 3 people that you're going to have to let go in 6 months because we're not thinking ahead. Using that just as an example, things to think about when we go through this. So what are the five key phases I'll spend my time on today? Number one, understand the environment. Number two, create a vision. 3, define the path. 4, tell the story. This is the one I am most passionate about. I will spend a lot of time on number 4 because it's something I feel very strongly about. And lastly is measure the progress. So understanding our environment, creating a vision, defining the path, telling the story, and measuring the progress. So let's get started. Understanding the environment. So let me give you guys a little bit of a hypothetical incorrect history example here. So no one hold me to these dates because I'm going to all be wrong. But so let's just pretend it's 1895, right? It's 1895. We're down the street here in downtown Dallas. And we've got this company. We're all the board of the directors of the company, right? We are the owners, board of directors, whatever. The company's future is all us. And we're sitting around the table and we're saying, okay, what are we going to do now? We've got this great company. What are we going to do? And someone says, you know, we're the best stagecoach manufacturer in the entire state of Texas. We're the best. I'd say we're the Cadillac of stagecoaches, but I don't know if that's relevant anymore. So we're the Cadillac of stagecoaches, and everyone loves us in Texas. And someone says, I got it. Let's go nationwide. Let's be the best stagecoach manufacturer in the entire United States. And we all high-five each other. Everyone's psyched. Yeah, that's great. We're going to do it. And we pull together an amazing strategic plan. Everything's mapped out. We know exactly what we're going to do. And 5 years later, guess what? We are out of business. Because we didn't know that some guy, Henry Ford, was building a Model T and being able to mass produce it. And guess what? Americans, they don't, or anybody, right? You don't want to drive horse and buggies and stagecoaches anymore. We got cars. Why? Because we didn't understand our environment. We didn't know what was going on around us. So that story may be relevant, you know, 100, 200 years ago. What about today? How many apps am I going to be able to get tonight that I couldn't get this morning? How many new technologies are coming out there as we speak? Are people around the globe working on new things? Our environment is constantly changing now, constantly. So it's a daunting task to try to figure out how are we going to understand that, but it's something we need to do. As project managers, does the project plan that you guys build out, your overall schedule, is it the same day one? Is it day 60? No, we change all the time. We've got to modify that. Same thing here. We've got to constantly modify a strategic plan and understand what's constantly going on in our environment. So how do we do that? Oh, sorry, jumped ahead. Let me get back here. So my hypothetical situation there about understanding about the stagecoach company in Texas. How about other companies, right? Any of these ring a bell? Building out their strategic plans. Were they aware of what was going on in their environment? Were they aware of the changes that were coming, right? These are real. These were big corporations with very, very, very smart people, right? So understanding our environment is absolutely key. So how do we do that? We ask questions. What are the needs of our customers? Now, if you're a large corporation offering products out to the marketplace or services, your customers will be externally. If you're in a business unit in some group that you're supporting, we'll take that small project management office. What business units are you supporting? What do they need from you? What are they going to need 3 years from you? Excuse me, 3 years from now for you? What keeps the leaders up at night? What do they worry about? If you guys are ever in a, they do these kind of, I don't call it like roundtable discussions with senior leaders, throw that one out there. You'll be like the smartest person in the room. Like, people love that, right? If they go, anybody have any questions for me? Go, what keeps you up at night? What do you worry about? People love that. But it's very incredibly insightful, right? What are they worried about? What are the threats out there that they're thinking about as they plan their business? What could potentially change in the industry? That could be huge depending on which industry you're in. Where do we see the industry in 5 to 10 years? As you start understanding the environment, there's millions of questions we can ask, but these are kind of the basic to understand what's going on around us. There are risk and regulatory changes all the time. There are changes in infrastructure all the time, changes in technology, changes in cultures, businesses, everything, right? So when we go to pull together, what we do is understand the environment, just asking questions. Your company, your business group, if you're doing this for large corporations, could have competitive analysis, research, thought leadership team. I have a benefit in my current role. I work with a thought leadership team. These people do nothing for a living but go out there and fly around the country and interview people and come up with all these great concepts. I have that I can pull from, right? They're people that they're paid to actually know what's going on in the world. Legal and regulatory, what's going to change? What do I need to be aware of? Now, this is understanding the environment is what I think of in strategy and planning, but then what did I think of and what does my mindset go as a project manager? I think of my stakeholder analysis. I think of understanding what my stakeholders would need. Strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, threats analysis, right? That leads 100% into trying to understand your environment and what opportunities can be out there. In project initiation, I always try to understand what's the context for this project? Why are we doing this? Why do people need this? What are the risks out there that I may have to consider when I'm building this project? Very similar to the mindset that we use in trying to understand the environment. And lastly, charter development. As we're kind of building out our overall view of, again, the context of the project, what does success look like, it's very similar to the mindset that we would use when we're pulling together understanding our environment and what that's going to look like. So on the left side of that, that's what I do from a strategy and planning perspective. But from a project management perspective, as I was going through these steps, I was just thinking about what I would do when I was managing a project. These are the things kind of in my little toolkit. You'll hear me refer to that often throughout the discussion. Our next phase, create a vision. A lot of discussion. I'm sure you guys have been involved in this path around visions and missions and what those mean. Excuse me. I've always simplified this in my mind. A mission is what a business group has to do to get the donuts out the door, right? It's what you do. The mission is what you do. The vision is much more of what you aspire to be, where you see yourself, okay? So what do we need to have in a good vision? It should be 4 components to a vision. It should be simple, easy to communicate, and understand. And that is hard to do. It is much easier to write essays than it is to write 2 or 3 sentences. It will not resonate with people. They won't understand it. They won't get it. They won't remember it if it's not simple, easy to communicate and understand. It needs to be aligned. It has to be in sync with the organization's value and overall plans. So if I'm in a business unit that rolls up into a larger corporation and my vision is to take my group over here and the company that I report into is vision to bring it over here, we're not in sync. It needs to be aligned. And if going back to that example, if you're leading a small project management team, your vision needs to be aligned with the stakeholders and your internal customers that you're supporting. If that's ultimately your customer base and success is really your success is tied to there, you need to make sure that you're aligned in what you want to do. And this is probably the most important. We're going to look at a couple examples in a minute, but it has to be aspirational. Inspire the team to go beyond their normal boundaries and to reach for excellence. right? This is the difference. A mission is we do X. A vision is something you aspire to be. It has to be something that motivates people and they buy into it. And this is, you know, what I said this in the beginning that, you know, I would challenge folks, and I won't call on anybody and call it out, but how many of in your business groups or business units have a vision? And then you look at employee engagement. You look at people dissatisfied. People are dissatisfied very often because they don't know what their work contributes to. They don't know, I'm working hard, I'm doing stuff, but what's it contribute to? So the aspirational component of a vision is key. It kind of rallies people. People like to be challenged. People want to be shooting for something that might just be out of their reach. I heard something the other day, and I'm probably going to totally mess up this reference, but they're saying anytime, if you give people a target of like 25, and 25 is attainable, they'll always hit 25 and stop. Like, you never go to 30, right? It's, everyone always hits kind of that minimum. So aspirational should always be just a little bit out of reach. Bless you. And lastly, it should be broad. It should not limit a team or an organization to one product or service. So if we go back to our stagecoach company in Dallas here, and we said we want to be the number one, the leader in the United States in transportation, maybe that wouldn't have limited us, right? Maybe we would have had a much broader perspective of what's going on as we went through and tried to achieve our vision. Because someone in the room can go, well, that's not a stagecoach, can't do that, right? Well, let's take a look at some of these examples here. Avery Dennison, now I won't read all these, but focus on a couple keywords. To be the world leader in products. That's pretty aspirational. Not, hey, best in class, not really good, world leader, right? And this is the whole broad component. In products, services, and solutions. I don't even know what that means, right? That means they'll kind of do anything. Products, services, and solution. Enable and transform. Consumers, business, gather, manage, distribute, and communicate information. But if you look at this, it's aspirational, world leader, it's broad. Solutions that enable and transform the way consumers and businesses gather, manage, and the rest, right? That kind of doesn't pigeonhole them to one type of thing. GM, this is one of my favorite. Be the world leader in transportation products and services. World leader. But this is the part I like. These things are really well thought out. We will earn our customers' enthusiasm through continuous improvement. They're telling you about their corporate culture in sentences. I guarantee you guys have PowerPoint decks of 700 pages that people are trying to communicate what these guys did in like two sentences. World leader in transportation, earn your customers' enthusiasm through continuous improvement driven by, so what do they expect of their people? Integrity, teamwork, and innovation. You're going to work for GM, you know what they expect. They expect continuous improvement. They expect you to have integrity, work as a team, and innovate. That's what GM wants in their people. All within their vision statement. And then Pfizer, we'll become the world's most valued company to patients, customers, colleagues, investors, business partners, and the communities where we live. How many people think of a company and think about the community where they operate? Right? There's a social aspect to this company. They're trying to tell you, not only are we going to do all this great stuff, but we're going to care about the places where we work and live. So these are all excellent examples of what we're talking about for a vision. Simple, aligned, aspirational, and broad. Right? There's not paragraphs and paragraphs of information there. Ultimately, your vision should be the organization's view of success. Now, I'm going to totally make this up off the top of my head, and we'll see how it goes here. But if I am running, let's say, that small business, small project management group, it might be something along the lines of, my team is going to provide we'll be a world leader, we'll say best-in-class project management services to enable our stakeholders to achieve their visions and goals. Something like that, right? I really did wing that. But it's something like that, that your team comes in every day, they know what they're there to do, right? And if you really think about it in the realm of project management, I always looked at my role as I want these organizations to be able to achieve that product, that service. They want to get that to market. They want to get that out there. That was my role to enable that, right? I was that person or part of that team to actually make that happen. How do you bundle that into a vision for your organization? So once again, using our project management skills here, what did I think when we were working in these business units, coming up with our vision? And truthfully, these things don't change very often. Your vision should be something that's pretty well, like I said, the environment's changed, things change, but if your vision is written correctly and it's broad enough, it shouldn't really change over time. Once again, I go back to project initiation. What am I thinking about when I'm kicking off a project? What am I thinking about interviewing my stakeholders, all the various pieces that are going into my project? Very similar, I think, in my mindset of what I'm thinking about the vision. What's success look like? My business objective, right? What does success look like in a business? It should be the, I'm sorry, what does success look like? It should be what you've outlined in your vision. I think about the communication plan because I think about how is this vision going to resonate with people? Are people going to understand it? What are the various stakeholders going to think about this? Is it going to mean stuff to people externally, internally, the people that work there? Or is it something that might only mean something to a subset of the population? So I think about how that would be communicated. And ultimately, like I said, it's really your project success criteria because your vision is your organization's view of success. So next phase, defining the path. So take a minute and if you wouldn't mind, just kind of read through this quote. This is one of my, everyone knows Sun Tzu, The Art of War, real famous book. People read it from business management. It's kind of like this, it's not really a book, at least in my mind. It's kind of like just a series of quotes and stuff. It's pretty neat, and I've actually picked it up, strangely enough, and read it every once in a while. But take a minute at this and go through this. So strategy without tactics is the slowest route to victory. Tactics without strategy is the noise before defeat. Anybody speak up? I'm interested in anybody what you think about when you see that. What does that mean to you when you read that? Well, I'll give you my perspective on this because, like I said, I read this quote over and over, and I know that sounds strange, but I really do. This gets to my whole thing where I was saying about people doing stuff, right? So in that first sentence, strategy without tactics is the slowest route to victory, but it's still a route to victory. If you have a strategy, it's going to take you a while. You'll get there. But if you don't have a strategy and you're doing stuff, it's the noise before defeat. I think this is absolutely brilliant when we apply it to business. This is where I think organizations and business units fall down. When we talk in this third phase here, defining the path, we are talking about creating the strategy. The strategy are the steps and the work that we're doing in order to achieve our vision. If you're working in a business unit or a company that's doing lots of stuff, but they don't really know where they want to go, you're going to waste a lot of time and energy, and people that are doing a better job of this are going to be more competitive, and they're going to get out in front of you. So, in defining the path, I believe that this is probably the most complicated, time-consuming part of strategic planning. This is where, throughout my time in this role, we would spend the most amount of time. It is complicated and hard. I spend very little time on it in this forum because I believe this is generally what project managers do. If I gave you a vision and I said that vision's your project and I said, get it done, you guys would automatically kick in gear and know what you need to do. So I try to just summarize some of the key chunks of work that ultimately go into this. So when we're defining the path here, we need to determine the efforts to achieve the vision, right? This was that work breakdown structure that I drew up on the board. What are the big things that we're going to do that help us achieve our vision and move this business forward? It's not the day-to-day operations. It's not the work we're doing day-to-day. It's the things we want to do to move the organization forward. Next, we want to use data to drive decisions and validate the plan. As you guys, I'm sure you're aware, and if you've gone through projects, I mean, there's pet projects, I call it there. People feel very strongly about things. I used to say one of my favorite things about project management or my successes was I was able to kill projects, which isn't always a good thing but for my stakeholders, but if it's not the right thing to do, we shouldn't be doing it. So using this data to drive decisions and validate the plans. Generally, we'll know, organizations know the work they want to do. If you're building this for your team, I'll use that example again. If we're using a small project management organization, maybe if your vision is to be world-class, best-in-class project management, maybe it's to get your team project management certified. Maybe it's to build out some of your big key deliverables. Maybe it's to build out a project management infrastructure. Maybe it's to pull together a communication vehicle to send out project status, things that you may want to do. But we have to make sure we're doing the right things to achieve that vision. So you constantly have to go back and use data to validate your decision. And then there's prioritizing the initiatives. This is very important in larger organizations. If there's 10 things that we want to do, these large, big chunks of work that we want to do, some of those chunks of work may be generating revenue that I need to do to need to then take that revenue and put it towards some of these other things I may want to do in an organization, right? All these big initiatives don't have unlimited funding. We've got to prioritize. What's the right thing to do? So as we talk about, you know, my project management tools, this gets into, actually both of those, the green and blue boxes, get into you know, your cost-benefit analysis, your ROIs, right? Does it make sense to do these? How much revenue is it going to produce? Do we have the people and the resources to get this work done? If not, which ones are we going to do first? And then it's assigned ownership. This is my absolute favorite part of strategic planning, because I spent my time with all these leaders and I built these strategic plans and I pull all this stuff together and I handed it to the senior leaders and it was their job to get it done. Very different than my role as a project manager where I walked out every room with I had, you know, the work to get it done. In a pure strategic planning effort, we work and drive these, the planning with the organization, determining those efforts, driving with data, prioritizing the initiatives, but ultimately we're assigning ownership. Business leaders own getting this work done. And we'll talk about it a little bit further. I still measured and drove the overall plan, but the ownership is ultimately on the overall individuals doing the work. So I put that note on there. Strategic management owns the plan, not the execution. It's my little project management hat as I go through here. So what do I do? What are the tools, the things I use when I'm defining the path here? Number one, work breakdown structure. It is, I know it's always been very important to me. The first thing I ever did in any project manage, that whiteboard, I started drawing those things up. It was the most helpful thing I've ever used in project management. It is absolutely critical to defining the path for a strategic plan. It's very similar. You know what you want to achieve with your vision. What are the blocks of work that we're going to do, the ultimate deliverables we need to be spending our time and energy on? A project schedule, and I think of prioritizing and critical path and trade-off analysis. What are we going to do? What can the organization support? One of the challenges with a big strategic plan for an organization, and I'm sure this is a challenge all of you guys have in your day-to-day world, there's that, the mission, right? There's getting the donuts out the door. How many people are sitting around today with their feet up at work going, boy, I can't wait to work on the stuff for this strategic vision? Nobody, right? It's stuff that we get done, unfortunately, in our spare time. Some business companies, I would say many successful business companies, have R&D departments. They have groups that are just purely focused on nothing but moving the organization forward, right? They're not getting the donuts out the door. But for, I would say in most cases, you don't have unlimited resources or dollars to do that. So we have to understand how all that's going to fit together. And as I put on here, I really think the entire project management body of knowledge could be used in defining the path. This is very, out of all the five phases we'll cover, this one is very much aligned with project management. We understand what that vision is. What are we going to do to get there? How do we work the organization to build that overall plan? And that plan, similar to project management, it's not just your schedule. It's your communications plan, your HR plan, your risk plan, all of that. All of those things fold into this. So next, tell the story. The fourth phase of strategic planning. So a couple different stories. Like I said in the beginning, this is my absolute favorite part of this presentation because I feel like, number one, if I had a button and I could change anything in the workplace, it would be around communication. Because number one, I think most people and most organizations are terrible. And it's interesting, I think we're actually going with, as technology advances, I actually think we're going backwards in all this. So this quote here, the single biggest problem is communication, is that the illusion that has taken place. So I'll give you guys another story here. So I was in that role in strategic planning probably for about 6 or so months. I was supporting a very large organization. It was probably at least three times a week I was in front of the senior management team. And I can tell you guys, I am a PowerPoint machine. I think in bullets and bulbs and things. I can create a PowerPoint in like seconds, right? I speak in PowerPoint, and I had all over my desk every strategic initiative that we had, what our vision was, how everything aligns, and week after week, I'm getting in front of the senior leadership team, and they're like, yes, 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 right? Everybody's like, this is exactly what we need. It was great. So I was feeling very good about my role. I was feeling really good about my job and everything we were doing. I was working up in Boston at the time, and a lot of folks, we had offices in like Rhode Island, Merrimack, New Hampshire, which here would just still all be Texas, but those are all small little states. And a lot of people came to the Boston office on Friday because they lived in the area, so it was kind of a shorter commute for them. So had one of these guys come by my office. His name was John, and he was a senior vice president, led a 200-person organization. Very good guy, knew him really well. It was a Friday at like 3 o'clock, so I was really shutting down. You know, it was one of those things I wasn't too focused on work. And he came into my office, and he was kind of leaning up against the door, and he's like, Jim, he's like, you know, I'm troubled. I go, I need some help here. And I go, oh, what is it, John? What do you need? He goes, I feel like we don't have a vision. We don't really know what we're working on, and we don't have any strategies. And I could honestly, I almost fell off my chair. I was like, what are you talking about? What do you mean we have no strategy? I've been working on this thing for 6 months. I go, blah, blah, blah. I start showing them the PowerPoints, whatever. And again, this guy had 200 people in his organization. He looks at me and he goes, I've never seen any of that. So there you go. My expectation was his boss and his boss's boss and all those other people were taking all the work that we were doing and sharing it with people, right? So if a tree falls in the woods and no one hears it, who cares? It doesn't matter, right? It doesn't matter. So as you look at developing your vision, your strategy, and your plan, if that's not getting communicated out to people, it doesn't matter. You won't be successful. So I'll start with a little, as we continue to go on this, we'll do a little history lesson here. No one's ever gotten this when I've quizzed anybody, so we'll see if anybody can get this. So in 2000, and Renee, you heard this before, so don't answer it if you remember. In 2000, at the changing of the millennium, whatever it was Discovery Channel or History Channel, I can't remember which one, for a week, or at least 3 or 4 days of a week, it was a couple hours every night, they had the 100 most influential people in the last 1,000 years. So from 1 AD to 2000 AD or whatever, that would be 0 AD to whatever, 1,000 years, 100 most influential people. So it had all your dictators, your inventors, your brilliant minds, had all this. But the number one most influential person in that 1,000 years, does anybody know who they said it was?
Mother Teresa.
Mother Teresa? No.
Hitler?
No. He was there, though. Both of them were there. That's good. Well, good for Mother Teresa.
Confucius.
Who?
Confucius.
No. Good.
Einstein?
No.
Gandhi?
Nope.
Aristotle?
Nope. But all brilliant minds, right? We'll leave Hitler out of this for now, but all brilliant minds, right? It was this guy. Anybody know who he is? Johannes Gutenberg. And what did he do? Right. So all of those brilliant ideas, all of these fantastic things, if you cannot communicate them, they're useless. Once this little device here was made, what's the first thing they printed? The Bible. Christianity spread around the world. And what followed it? Literacy. People learned to read. They had something to read now. Reformation. Revolutions. Ideas can be spread. Was it Thomas Paine, Common Sense, up in the Boston area, right? Rallied people to rebel against the British. I bring this up because to illustrate how, if you look at the development of humankind over time, if this guy didn't invent this little device here and able to get ideas out there, who knows where we would have been? It shows you how incredibly important communication is. Now, I'll flip this to what I was saying earlier. I feel like we're going backwards here. I feel like technology is actually hurting us here. Has anyone ever heard of this game, 52 Pickup? Maybe this could have just been my father. Okay. All right, good. So what? it's a game you play once, I'll tell you that much. So 52 Pickup, for those of you who don't know, and I remember my dad doing this to me, you take, hey, you guys want to play a card game? Yeah. And you take a pack of cards and you go, it's 52 Pickup. And you go, how do you play? And you flick the cards all in the air and you go, pick them up. Right, in my mind, that's what communication has become. I get inundated with everything, and people are like, well, you figure out what's important. Renee and I were talking earlier. I get inundated, as I'm sure many of you do, with teachers and coaches and advertisement. I get home from work. I've got like 75 emails to go through after I just went through 1,000 at work. We've gotten to a point where communication, we're just blowing ideas out there, and we can't tell what's important anymore. Back then, they were only spending their time printing things that were important or someone was paying for. So it's something we have to think about when we look in the modern times of how we're telling our story. So if we look at our strategic plan, bringing it back to what we're focusing on, a strategic plan, we need clear and simple messages to summarize the story. The vision, why it's important, how it will influence our work, how you, assuming if you're working with us, can be involved and contribute, and it needs to be positive and action-oriented. We need to engage and get team members involved. If we look at this vision of our company, our business unit, our group, it needs to be something that people are excited, engaged in, and care about. If not, you won't be successful. Leverage technology to deliver the message. So digital signage, internet sites, social media. I don't have a brilliant answer to this. I don't know the best way to communicate this. There are so many different avenues for this, but how do we do it in a way so that we're not just giving people more information they don't care about? Another example that I've shared and given this presentation before, a little bit about myself. I'm not a big TV watcher. I don't watch television very often. But, it's on around the house at certain times and we're eating dinner or whatever, things are going on. Second thing is, I am not in the market for insurance at all, right? I don't need any insurance. I'm good. Car insurance, home insurance, I got it. Here's stuff I know, and I'm this may come off as being a joke. I'm not joking. Listen to this. I know there's this woman called Flo. She works for Progressive. Seriously, she has a Name Your Price tool. I've seen her on a motorcycle. I've seen her on a boat, and I've seen her in an RV. She's on TV for less than 30 seconds. I don't care that she's on, and I'm not paying attention to her. Let me ask you guys how many presentations you sit through day in and day out that you can walk away and know as much as I know about Flo, and you were in that presentation for an hour. Our brains pick up information very different than the way we communicate it. As I said here, I don't have the answer to that, but some people in wherever, is it Madison Avenue, I don't know who does advertising anymore. People are studying how the human brain picks things up, and they're using that for marketing purposes. What can we learn from that? How do we get our message out there, whether it's anything, maybe it's a project status. How do we get this information out there where it's not a 75, you know, page Gantt chart that no one can read through? How do we get those key messages out there? There's things that we can look at outside of the realm of what we do every day. Advertising's one of them, to be able to engage and share this message and tell the story. And this isn't a one-time deal, right? It's continuing to communicate, it's scheduling periodic updates, and it's celebrating the successes, right? Very similar, again, to a project. I think what I've seen, I get to travel around in my job now. I go to various companies, and we spend a lot of time on the West Coast where, call it, you know, it's more of your, I don't know if we use dot-coms anymore, but more of your innovative technology companies. And you see a lot of very, very cool things that people are doing here. Now, look, I realize they take money to do. For example, this was at a company you guys all know, I won't name them, and I don't know the technology, so other people might know, but they have all these posters on their wall, which are kind of their strategy and their vision. And if you go up at your phone, and you know that, like, it looks like a barcode-y type thing? You know that barcode type thing? If you go up to that, what's it called? QR code? You can go up to that, and this is in their company, and you just scan your phone on it, and it'll tell you everything that's going on for that strategic pillar that that company's working on. Right? How cool is that? Like, again, we can't get that in my company. I don't have money to do anything like that. But it's things like that, thinking creatively, how we get our message out. If our achieving our vision is going to depend on all of our people being aligned and working towards that common vision, telling that story and communicating is absolutely essential. So, this one's pretty simple from when I think about this from a project management perspective. I think of my stakeholder analysis. Who are the people that I need to communicate with? What do they need to know? When do they need to know it? What are their, who's for me, who's with me, who's against me? You know, what's that whole base look like? And then ultimately my communication plan. How am I going to get this information out? It can't be something that we say, here's our vision and mission, and here's our vision, here's our strategic initiatives we're working on, and not update people on that. People need to know how we're moving forward. They need to know if that plan's changing. I just noticed I wrote the wrong number up there. It should be number 4. You guys should have called. Number 5, measure the results. So again, near and dear to everyone's project management, I think to your hearts, I can tell you that as a project manager and being in a business PMO, program management office for years, and being in strategy and planning, I had the same effect on a number of people. So I'd be that guy when I would walk down the hall, people would suddenly duck and go down the corner because they knew I was looking for an update on something from them. It was very similar, you know, when I was leading projects and I needed to know where we were on various initiatives. It was very similar when I was leading strategy and planning efforts, right? We need to be constantly staying on top of this and measuring the results. And that comes to a number of words that people absolutely hate. There we go, right? Everyone loves scorecards. You guys love updating QBRs, MBRs, status reports, all this great stuff. Unfortunately, again, I don't have a better way, but when we were managing large strategic plans, we use very much the same tools that we reported up in 2 projects. Reason being, almost all of the work that we were reporting on our strategy were projects, right? That's how we got the work done. You chunk up all that work, all those key initiatives, all those strategic priorities that we're working on, those were ultimately projects that business units were running with that I needed to stay on top of and manage. And in this, what I mostly care about, when we look at the bigger picture of a strategic plan, we're mostly care about those key initiative milestones. I never got down into the weeds of day-to-day project management. That was my old role, maybe your role today. The project managers were running with that. The business units were running with that. I constantly worried about key metrics or benefits realization. If we said we were going to do this to achieve this, I constantly had to measure that to make sure we were doing it. If our goal, one of our key initiatives was to get into a new marketplace that we were not in before, if we're in that marketplace and sales and revenue or other things aren't where they need to be, that's a problem, right? We might have made some assumptions. You said earlier, a strategic plan, very similar to a project plan, it changes because our environment changes and we need to constantly be modifying this as we go. Customer satisfaction. I highlighted that for a couple reasons. Number one, that's what I do today. My career is in customer satisfaction, where the organization that I'm in, we do, does anyone know what NPS is? Net Promoter Score? Folks heard Net Promoter Score? We survey all of our customer base. So those annoying things you guys are getting on websites and things that you go to, that's people like myself. That's what we do today. But very often, in a lot of these plans, you can get lost in all of this work and forget why you're doing it. So if you're not satisfying your customers, if they're not happy with what you're doing and you're not measuring that, your projects can be on time, on budget, the strategic plan, revenues, everything can be up. Might not be where we want to go. So it's very important to constantly be getting that voice of the customer in the work that we do. And that, again, goes if you're doing something internally. You know, I think all of this applies to even if you're running a business group within your organization, right? We want to be able to measure what we're doing is correct and getting that true voice of the customer. Constantly revisiting assumptions and environmental scan. As I said when I kicked off the presentation, things are changing constantly. I don't believe that there's, I shouldn't say that, I'm sure there are some businesses, but there are very few businesses, I guess I should say, where the assumptions that you make when you're pulling this plan are going to be the same a year from now because things are changing. Our environment, economy, things are changing constantly, more rapidly, I believe, than potentially any time in history. Your staffing and support model. So we might have wanted to do a lot of work, but maybe we just consolidated operations. Maybe there aren't people available to do some of that. That obviously factors into our overall plan. And then course correction or plan changes happens all the time. Change control is absolutely critical to a strategic plan, similar to a project. The one thing I would say this again, trying to compare and contrast the roles of project management to the roles of strategic planning, sometimes I'll be a little cynical here. Very often as a project manager, I was presenting out to my project sponsors and I had to explain why the project slipped, or I had to explain why we can't do this or we can't do that, or we might have to cut requirements. I never had to worry about those discussions because the people in front of me that couldn't deliver were those senior managers in their teams, right? It's very different in a strategic plan. They were the ones coming to me and my organization saying, here's why we can't do this. I'm like, okay. And I actually understood from being in project management. So periodic business reviews, whether those are monthly, quarterly, scorecards, key initiative plans. My little PM, I got no chuckles for any of these. I really enjoy these. My PM hat, no one even chuckled. Now I got my PM toolkit. So what do I think here? Project schedules, business benefits, ROI, net present value, time, cost, scope, constantly measuring that to our overall strategic plan, communicating the plan, and managing change. So the five key phases, I'll just review these really quickly. Understanding the environment, we need to know what's going on around us at all time, and it's constantly changing. Creating a vision. Your vision should not change. It should be aspirational. It should be broad enough so that it doesn't change. It should be really where you want to take your organization. The vision is your organization, your team view of success. Defining the path is how are you going to obtain that vision? What are those things you're going to do to get you there? Telling the story is communicating it, getting it out there to the organization. Make sure people understand it. Constantly communicating and reinforcing it. Like those progressive commercials, apparently they play 1,000 times. I know what they're selling. And then measuring the progress. And before we kind of open this up for questions, I'll just throw one other thing out there. I do believe, and this is not, you know, the purpose of this conversation, this discussion at all. As I said, you can apply this to corporations, business units, groups. Truthfully, I mean, again, I'm not anybody that should be coaching anybody on this. We really should be thinking about this like lives and careers, right? Where do you want to go? What do you want to be? Having spent my entire career in financial services, and I told you my job today is getting voice of the customer, you would not believe if I look at the American workforce that people aren't planning for 5, 10, 15, 20 years. So what do you want to be when you're 70 years old? What do you want to be doing? If you took these steps and applied them to your career and life plan, what's your vision for being 70? What's your vision for being 80? If you don't know that and you're not working towards it, probably with the exception of telling the story, unless you want to tell your relatives or kids what you're doing, All of these things apply to that as well. So I thought I would just leave you with that as you think through. So with that, I will open it up to questions.
I think, the mic is working. First question, you're first. Thank you.
Sure. Excellent presentation, by the way.
Oh, thank you.
I really believe that, you know, this thing should be practiced top-down. In the absence of that top-down implementation, you know, the strategy and the vision by, say, the PMs or the other worker bees just doesn't happen. So is there something that you can explain how we can apply in the absence of these things coming top down to us?
I will ask this. So again, I'll answer your question, but I would really be curious. Again, a lot of what I covered, how much of this you guys see? I mean, do you see your companies? And I'd love to know that. So if I understand the question, so as a project manager, as people contributing to the organization, how can you kind of leverage some of this and drive this within your organization, right? Is there a way that kind of like, if it's not coming top down, how could you push it kind of bottom up? I give you my two cents on that. I think that, you know, some of the things I was kind of joking throughout the discussion but were true is that if you're in an organization that truly embraces project management, and I mean that sincerely, where I've always kind of been the thing, I think people love project management as long as it's doing what they want them to do, but as soon as project management tells you something you don't want to hear, people don't like project management anymore. I think the opportunity to drive this up is that if we are asking the right questions of our project sponsors, and if we are challenging them to the true merits of the project, of like, why are we doing this? Does this contribute to what the organization wants, needs, and is going to move the organization forward? Almost bringing that in a little bit into your process. Again, I understand that could be politically sensitive, right? If I'm working with an organization and they are my suppliers of work for my business unit. But I think to the point, if you could push it up, it's identifying those opportunities where you get that voice to say, how does this tie to the overall initiative? There's and some of you guys would probably can phrase this better than I am. There used to be a certain thing on we used to do on, I think it was on the top of our charter, where it was, you'd have to ask your project sponsor, if you had a compromise on anything, would it be time, would it be your cost, or would it be scope? Which one of those would you never give in on, right? We used to have these little meter, and you would color one of them red or green or yellow, whatever. If you almost expand that a little bit, saying, well, of that meter, what is this project doing if we didn't do it to contribute to the overall success of this organization? How imperative is this to move our organization forward? I don't think that would necessarily create an overall strategic plan for the organization, but it might get people thinking about, you know, that doing stuff versus doing stuff that aligns with moving that organization forward. And some of that stuff can bubble up. I will say too, and this is, it differs for every organization, because I don't think every business unit or company has strategy and planning people. But I have seen those roles in the past generally be, or those organizations roll up into people that own the project management or the business PMO office. Because they were kind of that external group that kind of kept the business in check. So there could be a way to influence it that way as well. It's not perfect. Can I just get a show of hands? I mean, this is why I'd like to ask you guys a question very quickly. How many of you guys, and I don't know where any of you work, how many of you know what your business unit or your company's strategic plan is and you're contributing to it? How many people know that? Okay. That doesn't surprise me. I always thought, and again, I will not get political with any of this, knowing all the stuff people are thinking about. I would love for once in my life to actually turn on the television through all these debates and have someone go, here's my strategic plan for the country. And I would be like, holy, I would vote for that person. Like, you just saw this rhetoric. But like, that's what we should have for a country, right? Someone should be able to articulate all of that. So it's just interesting to look at. So,
you had a question? Thank you. Well, just like your pal that came in on a Friday afternoon, it's a similar situation. I was one of the people who raised their hand about, do you know your company's vision? Yeah, my company does a very good job of communicating that, but it does a lousy job of operationalizing it as you further down you go in the organization.
Yeah, I absolutely agree with you. I absolutely agree. And this is my response to that, or if I had explained why, it gets to that resource thing that I was sort of touching on. How many companies, business groups, whatever, have people that are truly focused on delivering strategic things versus truly focused on what the day-to-day is, right? Getting that job done. I'll give you guys a little thing. My company right now, and I think this is probably not just my company, a lot of folks, if I hear this word innovation one more time, I'm going to jump out the window, right? Everything is like, someone puts a new wastebasket in the restroom, it's innovative now. I'm like, but what I, here's my response to that, which I think relates to what you're saying. I don't believe, and I could be wrong, I've never worked for Apple or Google, but I don't believe people came in and said, I'm going to do these 10 things today, and when I have some time, there's this iPod thing I'm going to get to. Or you know what, I think I'm going to, it was their job to deliver those strategic things. I think we struggle in organizations where we don't have people whose job it is to deliver. So as that work gets operationalized, we don't. Everybody's balancing the day-to-day and all those hiccups and all various things that happen. We don't have people to deliver on those overall strategic key initiatives. I think that's one of the biggest challenges. And I think that's the challenge of management, right? I do think that's from the top all the way down. They have to be, if this is their vision, these are the things they're going to go after, you've got to invest in that. You've got to support that, have an infrastructure that actually delivers on that, or else you can kind of just spin your wheels.
Thank you for the awesome presentation. Very informative. I just have a random question. Can you talk about a project that you had to early terminate, shut down, pull the plug, it took us too long to execute, now the opportunity's lost? Can you talk about the red flags? How did you come to that determination? And just tell us a little bit about that. Thank you.
Yeah, sure. Thank you. Good question. I can tell you there's a guy that I've been working now for 10 years. He still won't make eye contact with me as I walk down the hall. I'm not kidding. So here, I'll give you an exact example. This is what this project was meant to do. So major financial services company, very, very large. Very large corporation, handles many of, I won't get into the specifics of it, they handle many of these expense payments that they pay out to these advisors. And they have this one person's job who comes in every day, and all she does is like 40 different spreadsheets, and she does all these things manually. And so the data comes from like 50 different sources, it's very complicated, but she does it all manually. And so this business group had been fighting to automate that process. And their battle cry was, if so-and-so, the head of our company, ever knew we were doing all this financial stuff on these spreadsheets, he wouldn't believe it. He would never do this. This is like key stuff. This is billions, millions, if not billions of dollars in like revenue stuff that goes out. Big money moving. So I think the project was estimated at maybe like $1 million or so, maybe more or less. Well, 6 months down the road, it was $2 million. And then it was $3 million. So ultimately, we're hiring one person to do this day to day. There's very little errors in what you do. We can afford to keep someone in that job for the next 40 years. Why would we automate this? But it became a pet project. It's something they had to get done. We have to do it. It was almost like it was almost like how could we be doing this in 2000, whatever it was, 13 in spreadsheets, when it's all manual and we could just automate it. But the problem was the data came from like 50 different sources and they couldn't automate it without spending a lot of money. So I was the one at the time I wasn't managing the project directly. I was overseeing that project portfolio. And at those meetings, I'm like, I think we should kill the project if it doesn't have any benefit to it. And they were like, well, she could make a mistake. Has she? No. Okay, so then we're good. That's pretty much one of the best examples that I have. But I'll say one other thing. I'll give you one other one. And relate it to this role, there were, as we talked about, there's some big initiatives, and particularly in most industries, right, there's automation, right? Automation's a big deal, right? We still do a lot of manual processing, I'm assuming, and a lot of, part of where we were trying to go with this organization, our overall strategy was around straight through processing and all these things. There was three or four platforms that they were using to basically produce financial statements, big expensive platforms. There was a project that was funded to bring all those together. And that project was 2 to 3 years down the road, way over budget. It was, you know, I would say this and no pointing fingers, it was one of those disasters, right? It was not going well. So being at that table in the overall strategy and plan, that wasn't going to give me the efficiency that we needed overall. It wasn't going down the right path. And at that point, it wasn't a path that I wanted, you know, an organization we wanted to go down anymore. So we had to cut that overall initiative. So that wasn't from the project management perspective. That was from the strategic plan perspective. I'm like, we can't sink that much more money in this thing. It wasn't going to get us enough. Very similar, right? What didn't have the ROI or the benefit that we wanted. That was one of those chunks of work that got pulled off. We'll live with the four platforms. think there's a question.
A question over here. Thank you.
I just had a comment that I thought about when you were talking about building the vision is that you have to be very careful when you set your vision, because once you do, people expect you to follow it.
Yeah.
And that's, so be careful.
So I appreciate you saying that. So there's a couple things. You go through these presentations, I have, you know, a lot of thoughts and notes on this. Here's why I think business groups sometimes don't do that, and I agree with exactly what you said. This gets a little bit to the, if you guys have heard this, the managing versus leading. In order to be a leader and come up with a vision, you've got to have conviction and you've got to be willing to commit to it. You're right. Once you say it, you've got to deliver. And I found in a lot of organizations, a lot of times people aren't willing to do that. They're not willing to commit to say, here's what we want to be. And, you know, maybe at the business unit, that's okay, because we, but at a corporate level, at a high level, that's tough, right? That's, if people don't have the conviction and the firm belief on where they need to go, that's tough for the people that work for that group, your stakeholders, shareholders, everybody, right? It's really, it's difficult, but you're spot on. Once you put that down, it matters. Yes, sir.
So you asked the group about, did they understand the strategy, the company's strategy, strategic? That surprised me, the answer, because a tenet of project management is to make sure your project lines with the strategy, the company strategy. So the response, how do you correct that so we all understand that better? Corporate does have a lot of secrets. They have a lot of management. I won't say secrets, but they do a lot of talking in closed rooms, and not a lot of that filters down. Project managers are given their marching orders. How do you suggest we correct that overall so we can help align that? We don't go awry with a lot of this money wasting and time wasting.
That is an absolute amazing question. It could be a little self-serving. My initial answer would be, that's why I think organizations need a strategy and planning function with someone that's out there to communicate that. Again, I hope throughout this presentation, I'm trying to draw the parallels, I think, between the strategy and planning and project management. I've had to, and I'm sure many of you, I've had a fight for project management in the past. Why do we need this, right? I've had a fight for strategic planning in the past. I think ultimately, if organizations have that group that can drive that, communicate it, and are outside of it, I think that's, in my mind, the best solution I can come up with. But, you know, to your, part of your question is project management, how could you drive that? It's kind of similar to the question earlier. I think it's awareness, it's asking those questions. I've always felt like it's been a slippery slope as a project manager with my relationship with my sponsor, right? I want to challenge them, but at some point, you know, I don't want to be kind of, you know, burning the bridges with the people that ultimately hire me to do the work that I do. But I think if you can, within your project teams, emphasize what we're trying to do and the importance of it, if you can tie that with, you know, if you have a PMO structure, maybe there's reporting that you can do that kind of tell you, here's the five things we are doing that are contributing to that work. It may be so much of this stuff, just in my mind, it always comes down to, like I said, number four there, telling that story. I think, to your point, I think most businesses do a lot of this stuff. They don't share it and get it out there enough. We don't constantly emphasize it. So maybe it's bringing that and, you know, getting a little creative with project charters and other documents of putting the vision, I'm totally winging this one here, putting the vision on top of your charter and saying, here's how that project contributes to it, kind of creating awareness around that. I think that's the best thing. My current boss right now, she has a great strategy. She calls it her drip campaign. I love this. It's like whenever she wants to get something done, you just always drop little drips here and there. And so maybe this is a little bit of a bottom-up approach of constantly putting that out there where people start seeing it and it's constantly reminding them of the importance and why you're aligning it. Yeah.
Is there a question up front here?
It was a comment. It wasn't a question.
You go ahead.
So when we were talking about vision, and that gentleman over there said that, you know, people expect you to do it. Similar with the names of the organization, when you start a product or name your website, you're thinking of your immediate project and or product. And then when you diversify, that name looks funny then. So
right.
I've seen many cases like that. So when you're thinking, you should think big. From the beginning.
Right. That's, and you're absolutely right. That's the whole point. When I look at a vision, that's the whole. Oh, I'm sorry. Very much like the question was around if you name a product or a service or a company a certain thing, you're kind of tying into like the image of that, right? It means something. So very similar to like with a vision, you're tying yourself into, you're putting in writing, it means something. So make something extreme. I'm going to be the so extreme. I think if you're going to call your company or your product Red Rabbits, and you're selling cars, it might not make sense, right? But it's the point. I know that was extreme. I was trying to But you're absolutely right, and that's why one of the key components of a vision is it needs to be broad. If you look at the major companies, right, GM says, we're going to play in transportation. What is that? Spacecraft? Ships? Planes? They've got a broad, you know, spectrum of products and services that they can offer. I forgot which one it was, Avery Dennison that was up there. Like, we just want to produce products and services to help our, they can do anything, right? They didn't tie themselves in, right? And I think that, you're right, it's having that broad enough view where you want to give direction, right? You want to be able to know what it is, because you could also sit in the room and go, that's so broad, I don't know what we should be working on. That can come out of it too, right? You can be a little bit too vague there, but it is absolutely critical to be able to identify what resonates with people, but also that's actionable and you could contribute to, or your organization can contribute to.
When you talked about, like, for the missions and visions, you kind of made a, you know, you did an impromptu creative vision, like in the project, but how often do y'all actually do that as a practice to encourage departments and those to write their own, or even further down to, yep, to specific teams?
Very excellent question. Yes. So let me. Yes, we actually do that very frequently. I will say that most, in my experience, and I would say most companies today, they have their visions pretty well set, right? I mean, I would say most, right? You can go to any website, you're going to see it's very straightforward out there. Where we spent a lot of our time was exactly what you said, bringing that down to the various business units, saying, okay, here's what the broader vision is. Because if you look at, again, I was part of a very large company. A business unit was 6,000 people, right? It was a company in itself. Those at that level in the organization I was working in, they didn't, right? They would very much, if you said, what's your vision? They would tell me what they do. We do this. Like, oh, okay, that's good, but that's really your mission, right? That's what gets the donuts out the door. What are you doing 5 years from now? What do you want to aspire to be? And I can tell you, this literally got, and this was an extreme at one of the business units I was supporting, and this is, again, a little cynical part of me. We worked with them, they came up with a bunch of stuff, and they had to hire consultants. They hired consultants and come in and really work with them on what their vision was for their organization. And it was just like, it was literally like your corporate list of, you know, buzzwords, you know, best in class, world class, which was good, right? They wanted to be aspirational and get that stuff out there. But we would actually take that down to all the various business units and the groups and help them develop what is it that you want to ultimately be and what does success look like. And why it was critical in some of the business groups that we supported, because those services, although they were ultimately part of the same company, those services within financial services are offered by vendors. They could outsource at any time. So we had to really challenge them. So as the head of the company sits back, like, what are you there to do? What is your vision for this? If we didn't have that, it was kind of hard to come up with like a value proposition. Why would I stay with you versus go to an external vendor? So it was something that really helped them build out. And it's, you know, I purposely put this to make this very simple, right? These are really simple concepts ultimately. I know, needless to say, it's very hard, right? This is a lot of hard work. We've debated over words and visions where people have 20 minutes, we're sitting there going back and forth, and at some point, it doesn't really matter, but you want to get the gist of it. And then when you start, again, fleshing it out and developing that path and all the things you're going to do, it makes it so much easier once everyone kind of agrees on what the ultimate vision, what the company wants to be, or the business unit wants to be.
So my question is, what do you think out of these five key phases is the most challenging, and where do companies need most help?
Good question. Number three, defining the path. Yeah, so I think defining the path is the most difficult, and as I was saying earlier, I don't spend a ton of time on that because I think that's how we're wired. Again, assuming everyone with project management background, we very much take a very vague concept and then we have to build it into actionable work. That's very, very difficult to do because the one word I haven't used at all today, and I'll throw out there now, it gets into politics. You get particularly with larger organizations, everybody's got an agenda. If certain business units are not part of that critical path to delivering on that vision, that could impact the head of that group's compensation. And he wants that to be the number one thing because it's going to get the most attention. You deal a lot of that, with a lot of that. And that's where, again, it helps, you know, this is where having the political clout in an organization, having that support, where sometimes you got to draw the line and go, this is what we're doing, whether this guy or whoever wants it or not. That to me is the hardest part of it. The easiest part, and which we don't do well, again, I'll go back, I think, telling the story, the communication aspect of it. I think that's easy, or could be easy, but I think we organizations tend to fail on that part of it.
And, oh, just one sec here. Yo, we have lots of time.
So I like the part about tell the story, but I want to know if you ask the story, because you talked about your thought leaders and your business units and your stakeholders. And I found that even though you've told the story, you need to go back and ask them, is the story still relevant? Is it hitting to what you need today?
Yeah, you're absolutely right. So I think part of telling that story is it's almost, we'll call it the never-ending story, right? Because it's always going to change, and things will constantly change. And I think where, you know, a little bit to when we were talking about earlier about things getting down, right, the operationalizing, I do believe that in a large organization, people are not very forgiving when things change. By that, I mean, like, if said, hey, here's the things we're going to do, this was the strategy, I think as you get, you know, further along in leadership, and you guys all know in projects, things don't always go as planned, right? They blow up all the time. We make all the time, just like in projects and in strategic planning, we make false assumptions, right? We make mistakes. It happens all the time. Filtering that down and actually being the leader and saying we made a mistake, that's part of that story that needs to constantly get communicated. That means people believe in it, right? They buy into it. But you're right. We would actually, part of what we would do, and I don't have a perfect example to a lot of that telling the story, but the things that we've done I think were successful were, we would do like quarterly strategy updates for the organization. Whenever there were all hands meetings, we would attend those, and we would bring in things like you said, here's what our original assumption was. If you had thought leadership researching, here's what's changing in the environment. Here's what we went after, but that's not relevant anymore. X, Y, and Z change. We're actually going to go this direction. One of the organizations that I was supporting, they had a massive, massive bet on outsourcing, right? They were going to move an entire organization to another country to do a ton of work. They did that for 2 years, and it absolutely failed. So we had to take all those the FTEs heads and bring them back in on shore. That was a big thing that we had to go out, and I helped them kind of craft that story and go out to the organization and say, we were wrong. This is what we tried to do. It didn't work. We need to bring those opportunities back here and whatever. So it's constantly, constantly evolving, and you need to be always sort of supporting your story so that it continues to resonate. And you kind of have to keep it fresh, right? People don't want to hear the same thing. I can tell you again, I'm not, so this role in strategy and planning did for a number of years. I'm in this customer insights role right now. It's a little bit frustrating for me, for the business group that I'm in, because what they do is they pull together kind of your picture of your strategy, and they go, well, our strategy hasn't changed for like 3 years. And that's all they talk about. I'm like, but it must have changed in the last 3 years, right? There has to be different things we have to be doing, or else it's probably not a very, you know, a good strategy in what they're doing. But I feel that today in my role, the frustration that I'm not really getting the full communication and fleshing out that story to give me all of what's going on behind the scenes. So then I, you know, how can I contribute, right? It can't all be going that well. So that's a good point.
Any more questions? Is that it? Do you see anybody up front? Well, thank you all very much for wonderful questions.
Yes.
Jim, you did a great job. I really appreciate it very much.
Thank you
very much.
My pleasure. Thank you, everyone. Thanks so much. Thanks. Great questions.